All right, no public comment today, so approval of minutes. I'm going to be abstaining, so I'll call upon you guys to move this forward.
We got one question under the tree board. Tree inventory update. The sentence kind of got left off there. Snowstorm caused many downed tree limbs and a few small trees were broken. Is that what it's supposed to be?
I don't know if it's that.
Just wondering.
I think those, okay.
I think that the adjective down goes with both. Downed tree limbs and a few downed small trees.
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
I'll fix it. Thank you.
Jen, do you want anything under that other business not anticipated to reflect our comments around future process or thoughts around reviewing the landscape components of street plans?
Oh. Sure, if you think it would be.
What's your topic?
Helpful. We have that in other minutes as well, too. Yeah, I don't know what I'm saying.
Okay.
Yeah, so let's just leave it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, minutes have been approved as they stand. Yes, I abstain. Okie dokie. I don't have much of a chair report. I've been gone for a while. Some of you may not know why. So I just want to acknowledge this meeting in that context. I think a lot of us worked really hard to affect a very different outcome than what we just faced. And I think that it brings a lot more relevance to our work going forward in the absence of federal support for care for the environment and climate action. So I just wanted to articulate that and remind us that our work is really important. Especially for mitigating climate change locally, the effects of global warming locally. It, for me, it gives all the more reason why we should be planting trees aggressively and really strategically. So, anyway, hope you guys are all doing well. I'm still in the ball. Other than that, I really don't have anything much here.
Oh.
I mean, I have other things that I can talk about later on in the agenda.
Just a couple of things. The tree inventory, the data collection should be complete by the end of business day today. So as of this morning, I had a visit, a site visit with two of the arborists. They've been doing the work in the last 2 weeks, and they had 180 trees in total, which they probably would be filling up pretty quickly today. So I actually sent them, I asked them to go back out to the woodlots along Route 66 and areas of Florence Road that were originally measured with the 25-inch DBH material they use, so they dropped that down to 6 inches like they did the rest of the woodlots. So they're trying to capture the rest of those trees. But, so we've captured roughly, I believe, about 10,500 trees in public right away, and the rest are city park trees, cemetery trees. But I'm waiting for an updated email.
Is this regularly updated? Or could this, because this says 9,750.
No, it's not updated.
Oh, okay.
It's probably updated every few days.
So how far out did they get?
We'll see.
They got everything?
Everything.
That's crazy.
And we're pretty close on the estimate then.
Well, we're, yeah, I mean, we're yeah, we're actually, well, Lily and I had a conversation the other day, and the original estimate, I believe, the tree sample was, already 8?
Well, it was between 8 and 11,000.
So we're on the high end.
So we shot for our high end, and that's what we ended up needing.
And it actually worked out because we're fortunate enough to have enough because of the way that the actual bidding came in, you know, we actually had enough room in our ceiling to actually capture the city parks at least.
Yeah, that's good.
So.
And that includes all the parks?
Yeah.
And the cemeteries?
Yes, all the city cemeteries.
It's awesome. Can you see what they did that nice? Yeah. I just can't wrap my brain around that. It took us so long to do like 400 trees. That's great.
So that's, so I have to get together, gotta kind of try to figure out what the timeline is going to be for the delivery of the urban forestry management plan. And then we're also working with, now that the data entry will be completed, Andy Keither is going to work with their GIS folks and then get people in their GIS department to get Treekeeper up and running 100% so we can actually start to really use it to generate, to experiment with it, generate work orders. And then to do data entry myself, because I know that there are trees that they did miss and catching those and go along, only because they use the assessor's map really as the main guideline as to what trees to capture. So our assessor's maps are not completely accurate when it comes to the right of way. The widths are pretty correct, but the way that they're actually laid out on the maps, you know, in reality, the street goes this way and the assessor's map goes this way. Mm-hmm. So it's, some of them are spot on, some are not so hot. I mean, downtown it's very easy to delineate what's a public street tree and what's not, but I don't know, you go up 66 halfway and it's totally different. 66 is pretty good though, because it was just redone. There was a lot of land taken by the state, but like Florence Road, it's like no man's land, very wide layout, and it's segmented. So we have to use cards to figure out what's what. So I will do data entry as I need, and then we already have public shade trees that we've identified in our own system, our own database, that we know are public shade trees. So if we want to cross those trees and not in this database, then I can just, they can just be migrated because it is GIS compatible.
Will you be putting in the setback trees? They're public for like 2 years and then not, so you won't.
I gave them the list of all the trees we planted.
Yeah.
So I have not really looked to see if they added the trees that were set back.
Right.
You can probably tell by just going to a couple of sites, but I haven't got that far.
But I mean, would it be your intention to put them in or not? I don't know. I mean, I don't need an answer.
Yeah, I guess
I would say if we're going to lose them in 2 years, it's not really worth the effort. Right.
Although the only thing that I would say about that is that I agree with what you're saying, but on the other hand, in order to actually
keep track of watering,
actually to understand what the value of all the trees that we have presently in our inventory, including the ones we just planted, you know, if you start to lop off the same legal harness setbacks a year, just lopping those off and not adding those to our estimated benefit, our overall city benefit calculator, which I think is kind of an important tool to use for informational things, also for funding requests and things of that nature, so.
We should probably discuss that and make a decision later on, whether we want to do that or not.
Also, I'm just wondering, as technology improves, will there be an easier way to capture that for, say, like LiDAR, where you can really, you can get a quick snapshot of our canopy? In my view, the tree keeper gives us a lot of important detailed information, but setbacks to me fit into the larger, more like, what's our aggregate tree canopy? Then what do we need to prune? What do we need to water? Certainly watering for the first couple of years, but it just feels to me like it's a separate data set.
For diversity of species too, though, we should probably have somewhere a list of what we planted.
Actually, that's a really good point, because in terms of diversity of species, the greatest diversity of species will be setback trees, because that's where you can plant a lot of very diverse trees. There's a limit to the setback easily put into tree belts.
Right.
So maybe Keith and I talked a long time ago about setting up a system where people can input their own trees on a separate layer on the city maps. Mm-hmm. So that you have that information, but they can't get in and tamper with other things.
I don't know, amazing detail that they picked up. I mean, they picked up they even put in little saplings that just happened to grow in the tree belts. So they examined the tree belt. I can now go in and really look at the tree belts.
Yeah, did other people get a chance to look at Tree Keeper?
Incredible.
I just looked at the street that I know well, which is the street I live on, and they were completely spot on.
Yeah, it's updated, so if you go to our webpage,
you
get into the link right there.
Okay. So I do recommend you going on and at least look at one street that you know and see, this is going to be our last chance to catch inaccuracy. So far so good, so what I've seen.
A very small comment goes back to the diversity that Jim spoke about. I looked at different species as of a week ago, which is most of all the trees. And I looked at the species that we're currently planting. And yellowwood trees, there were 29 in the city. Tulip trees, there were 10. Sweet gums, there were 7. Packberries, there was 1.
Do you mean ones you just planted or ones that are
total,
entire city?
Total.
And they, are only 10?
And that includes the ones that we
just
planted. So if they're in there, they're buckeye trees, 2, we planted them. American elm, 74. Hackberry, 1. I'm just saying that looking at what we're planting and looking at the whole of what exists is, of course, what we're going to be doing and where those trees can go.
One more question. Where in the Tree Keeper do we see their site choices for new plantings?
That's going to be in this version, which I have.
Okay. Are we able to access that?
No, because this is not a read-only. So this is the actual system that actually operates the work orders and everything. So that's the read-only version. I could actually make a note to ask them to see if they could actually update that.
The version that's up there, when you go to search, the first category of search doesn't work. Do you notice that? And then if you go to...
You mean just the search bar?
Yeah, if you go to advanced search, then you can actually do some searching. So it's not, must not be fully functional or something.
Okay, is there anything else on your...
No, we've finished cleaning up all the storm damage from the miniature snowstorm we had. Today actually we're on a bike path, it was the last day, so we're actually Terry's been inundated with phone calls and inundated with work orders since the last meeting with other tree issues,
tree inspections, tree plantings. Got probably about 700 because of the storm. Trees were damaged beyond repair, I should say, or beyond worth keeping them. So, don't have any public shade tree hearings at the moment. We're going to be working to plant the larger trees that we're going to have to move over next week. Try to get those done and over with. And then we also have a large tulip tree we have to move that we have to coordinate. So we're going to have to connect.
Short week, that should go well.
Yeah, next week, I don't think we'll be able to do the big tree, but I think we'll be able to do at least all the other trees.
The locusts.
Speaking of hearings, if it is your judgment that to move a tree, we need to have a tree hearing, then I would like to suggest that we schedule some tree hearings at some point in the, not too distant future for the trees that we feel are not best placed on South Street.
That's fine.
I don't know if you have trees ready to swap them out, but I guess at least we can move them to other places.
We don't have any trees, actually. I think everything we have is spoken for in the location.
Okay, all right. Well, then let's just keep that on the back burner.
Okay.
Because those trees are going to be, easier to move.
So when you move over, you're going to want new locations for the ones you're removing?
Well, it would make sense. It would make sense just to swap them out and just put them into the right location.
Right.
So we probably ought to identify. Do you have a
couple.
A list?
I have a list. No, I mean, I could like flag them.
Yeah, like
or I could just
email.
Email address. Okay.
Yep.
Well, I would like to not be the only one to make that judgment. So maybe Jay, would you like to do a quick rundown on South Street with me?
Yeah, we could do that.
Okay.
Well, if you let me know when you're going to do that, I can look up the time I can meet you.
Okay. Tree inventory update. You
want to
say anything else?
I have an update from the other day, but it's not accurate. We're still stuck at the same amount, like 2019 planting locations. And we are today, as of today, we should have 11,200 trees. And then they also threw us an extra bone of like 100 some other stumps we have to take care of.
Which is that website on the minutes accurate? Northampton Mass or ma.mytreekeeper.com? The website?
Yeah, it's northamptonmass.mytreekeeper.com. Yep. How many stumps? And were you at all surprised by the number of urgently hazardous trees?
To be honest with you, yes and no. I have to say that some of the trees that I thought were hazards or higher risk trees ended up not being higher risk trees. So it's interesting the different perspective that every arborist has. Mm-hmm. Of course, you're on the ground. So when you're on the ground, you only see, what you can see looking at the binoculars. I mean, there's the tree that's over on Harrison Avenue, the sugar maple that was identified as not an imminent, but probable. It's the one that was next to Dr. Fisherman's, or is from Dr. Fisherman's house, 684 Harrison Avenue. I think the thing is that because of the nature of, once the report is completed, it's all, we can start actually filtering through it and pulling out all these trees and we can actually look at them all. And that's really what the goal is. So it's really not only the inventory, what we have, but the known condition of all these trees. And determine, do we agree with Davey's assessment or do we disagree with it? We want to add to it and say this tree doesn't really have brought to my attention there would be hazards that we mitigated to. We have to remove the next one, which is on Warner Street.
Yeah, no, I think they've done a really good job.
Shows that you have done a really good job too.
Yeah, right?
Trying. It's just a lot. It's pretty amazing, actually. I think about where we were, I don't know, just 10 years ago, how different things are. I just start scratching my head. It's funny. I'm excited. I'm kind of looking forward to now that the trench permit season is almost over, so that's going to be a relief for me, so I can actually kind of shift my focus now, because the last 2 months has been crazy with contractors wanting last minute permits for projects that should have been in April. You know, and we have a whole bunch of home permits to do with planting. So it's just a lot of moving parts, so I'll be able to actually be able to focus on some more tree topics. I do have to actually, you know, work on our Tree City USA application. And I'm waiting for Joe Cook to come back with the grant extension paperwork that I sent out to him for the mayor to sign, extend the grant to June 17th. So,
speaking of the mayor, since we still have a few more minutes before we have to move on to our next agenda item, is there any movement in Todd and my original outreach?
Well, there has not been any movement from the mayor's office. There's been more internal movement to myself, Carolyn Mish, and Louis Hasbrook. Uh-huh. And so Carolyn and I both agree that we have actually done a much better job of communication this year, but we need to continue to move forward and communicate more effectively. I'm also going to, we have to actually, Carolyn and I would like to sit down and develop a criteria for site plan review that actually will be required of every developer, that the type of inventory that we're going to be looking for. Because what we found in reviewing the plans on Pleasant Street, was a good example, is that the inventory of the existing trees is all kind of mixed in with what, you know, each segment of the construction plan is going to do. So I am going to work with them to try to get us a separate document that is rolled up with the plans that is the inventory of all the trees that are significant trees.
That was one of the requests we made coming out of the Pleasant Street review, was a separate landscape plan.
Yes.
Or landscape inventory.
Yeah, so if you can't get it through the actual, you know, the 2x3 sheets, then actually a separate, you know, you should have an, you know, arborist should come that works for the developer or for the builder and actually do an inventory like they did in Village Hill, or like as they did on Linden Tree Care, did an inventory for our Run Hill project. So I have a separate inventory sheet, which actually identifies the trees and their conditions. Is it going to have tree protection? And then I also have to develop with engineering, because I really would need to have a set of criteria for tree protection. So right now what I'm using for tree protection, because every time I meet with someone, I'm actually using the ANSI standards, and I'm not really supposed to give them a copy of them because they are a copyrighted document. So I'm not supposed to use them as our standard. So we have to develop our own standard that is based, not a carbon copy, but based upon the ANSI standards.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Jeez.
It's copyrighted material.
So we're not getting any money for it.
Yeah. But I can't hand it out, though, I don't think.
I don't think that's true.
I think
that's not copyright laws. Don't.
You're not making any money from it.
Yeah.
You can.
Well, it depends on.
It's a one single copy going to what? That's.
It depends on how you got the copy. If you made it yourself or you got it from them. If you got it from them, it's fine. But if you make it yourself, that is a potentially infringement.
That's copy. So what I do is I have made partial copies of the booklet, and I use partial copies to give to each developer. Then mainly I deal mainly with folks that are doing driveway permits and trench permits and things. So
yeah, I know, for instance, with music, if you make a copy, that's hand out, that you have to buy the original.
So again, I think it would be good for us to have our own standard, similar to the standard we have for the trees that we want to plant. I think it really would be, this is our standard, and this is what it is, and
I think it would be good to develop that. So I'm working on that, and I'm also working on what I think we should be asking for inventory criteria from site plan review. And it would be part of the application that goes out from planning to the potential developer. It's not presently in that, it's not presently packaged that way.
So in terms of the role of this body in supporting you there, our plan of action had been to go and try to convene a meeting with the mayor, with the mayor's consent and some of these heads. Are you suggesting that you're now in a place where you're going in a different direction and you're comfortable with that and you want to?
I don't think I'm going in a different direction. I think I'm going in the same direction the commission wanted to. But I work with these folks every day, so I don't think that a conversation, I don't feel that we need the mayor's support to move this forward. I think there's enough interdepartmental communication that we can actually talk to folks in the planning department on my level, or even we can even have folks come here from the planning department. Carolyn could come back here and we could speak to Carolyn if you'd like. But I don't necessarily feel like we need to have a huge general conversation. I think what they need is they need some draft documentation from me. This is what I would like to see as a tree board in your site plan approval application sent to these developers. And then there's another piece of that I can use the same thing for when we actually hand out driveway permits. So when people come into our office for driveway permit, especially in lots that people are dividing lots up everywhere now because they can. So there's a lot of trees that are impacted. So driveway permits are really kind of a control mechanism for me for the tree aspect of things. But I also, at this point, when I go out, I meet with every potential builder that's actually taken up the driveway permit, and I review all the trees that are there. Like them, they're not required to provide us with an inventory because they don't have to, because there's nothing that says they have to on their property. But in the public right of way, I can see what's there. I measure them, and then I say this tree has to be protected this way. This tree has to be this way, this is allowed, this isn't allowed. And then I follow up with another inspection. I refuse to sign the driveway permit until I get the trees are protected. That is a lot of leverage, because without a driveway permit, they cannot get a building permit. Without a building permit, they can't do anything.
And the guideline you use for tree protection is the ANSI standard.
That's correct, yeah.
Okay, so I just want to hear, since Todd, this was your kind of original brainchild, I just would love to hear you chime in about this, before we decide to, I won't say shift gears, because I think we're still moving in the same general direction, but approach it a little bit different.
I'm not sure if I have too much to add. I mean, if Rich is satisfied with the process that is going forward, then that might be enough. I do worry that the process itself is not legitimized and written down somewhere, that there still appears to be no real kind of handed off checklist of things that everyone is aware of from day one. So I still think the structure, the flow chart of permits, the paperwork itself, and the submittal requirements for any submittal still seem to be a little up in the air.
Wonky.
Yeah, like if you left or Carolyn left.
Right. So that's why in the checklist for the site plan application, one of the boxes is going to be significant tree inventory. The tree inventory, developer must have a certified harvest completed inventory of all trees within the property and on the public right of way with a separate document. Those are the kind of things. That's where you would interject those things, and then it would be written in stone. It's similar in our office, the driveway permits. This winter I have to spend some time with the driveway permit. Actually, I have some criteria on the driveway permit that says that all public streets are protected by NDL Chapter 87, but I need to have a document to go with that driveway permit. so each individual person who takes on understands that this is what is expected of them. So what I do now is I meet with them and bring the paperwork with me. Sometimes it's more effective. I find that the contractors and developers, they take the papers and they go.
Yeah.
Especially after the planning board, or after I sign off, you know, on a, after I sign off on a driveway, which I don't do anymore until I actually find a tree protection. And now, I mean, it's this time of year in particular, it's, people are in a rush to get things done. You know, I, no, you can't do that. Tree protection comes first.
Okay, so what about the suggestion of me inviting Carolyn Mish to an upcoming meeting?
That would be great.
That way, if there are some devilish details that we want to try to work out in terms of this checklist, that, you know, that might be an opportunity to do some brainstorming around that. You know, and just to emphasize that our goal is not to have everything just working really finely between two people on kind of an operational level, but to actually institutionalize this stuff. So I'll go ahead and invite her then, if there are no objections.
I just want a quick point of clarification. If I, let's say I split my lot and I'm, to save money, gonna be my own contractor and I'm gonna hire people, could I come to the city and say, look, I'm gonna build a unit over here and I've never done this before, right? Is there a sheet of paper that says you have to get a driveway permit, you have to do this, you have to do this?
Building department.
They have it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because what you're going to be doing is it doesn't require site plan review.
Okay.
Maybe AR, but not okay. Site plan review. So what happens okay. Is that the building department, just say if you want to build a house, brand new house, on a lot that's under 2,000 square feet, no site plan review, well,
so
the building department.
So would this thing that you're working on also impact that? Like?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so my goal is to make sure that everyone that actually hands out some kind of information to a potential contractor, developer, on that document is they understand that there is a significant tree ordinance for site plan review, because that's separate. Driveway permit will have a box on there that says all public shade trees must be protected, mm-hmm. And no work shall be commenced until public shade trees are protected for the tree warden. Same thing on top of a building permit, because the building permit, you know, that's where I think we've lost some of our, not our traction, but we've lost, that's where things have fallen through the cracks. You know, we've had Massachusetts Street was a really good example of just a total, you know, the building permit totally, you know, they issued a building permit without a driving permit. It never happened before since I've been all here, I've been here. So, I think that's where us communicating at the operational level and then producing documents that actually fit the bill for everything will be really good. The other thing is that when the city changes over from its present workflow system and goes to municity, all these documents will be online. And you can just go online and you can pick the menu that you want based upon what you're trying to do, and it will send you in the direction that you have to go. Right now, you know, if you want to drive a permit, you have to go to the Department of Public Works in person. You have to go to the building department in person. So hopefully the goal is to tie all of these things together. But you have to have the right documents and the right criteria for each one.
I'm going to move this along. And I mean, I'll take one more question, but at this point, we've been talking about this for a while. It's not really on the agenda.
Just real quick, there's really two trigger points, right, for submittal requirements. Those that require showing and dealing with a public shade tree, and those that trigger the significant tree ordinance that we were involved in 2 years ago.
Correct.
And those two submittal requirements should be, you know, pretty clear as to when you got to show one and when you got to show both.
Correct.
And I don't think that, I think that's sometimes where we get into the, at least from our, I mean, there's a lot more things we could get worried about, but
right.
Primarily that's it. That's all we're really concerned about, right. Showing those two things and then where it goes from there.
Yeah, I mean, it just requires a lot of review. And this is what, like the Village Hill project, one quick example, and I'll be done talking, is that, you know, there was a set of plans that got slipped through the cracks that I didn't review. But it was a document that was approved prior to the significant tree ordinance. So they came for a driveway permit, and I happened to catch on the plan that there's two public shade trees that they had to have removed. I would have never have seen those before if it was so. It's, the original submittal should have shown that when they did the actual, I should have been made aware of it originally a few years ago. I was not, I wasn't the tree warden, but it wouldn't matter. I should have known anyways. But then the driveway permit is what kept it in check. Yeah. So Todd is correct. Those things all need to be lined up so they all are basically speaking the same language. So I think we'll get there. But I think you're right, Carolyn, would be very beneficial.
Good. Done. All right, moving on. Filling a commission vacancy. So I was absent at last meeting, but I understand that we had a visitor, Molly Hale, who actually came to kind of check out the commission because she's interested in potentially applying.
And we behaved ourselves.
That's because I wasn't there. So there are a couple of things. First of all, I just wanted to open it up and say, has anyone heard any other murmurings of people interested in applying?
Has there been any notice put out? Do we want to put a notice out? Do we want to keep it?
It's not really our job.
Yeah.
That would be the job of the mayor, and I don't know if they post vacancies, except for that you go to the tree commission website and maybe see that it's a vacancy. I don't even know if you.
Yeah, they're posted deep on the website, but like, I mean, they're with everything else. So.
Yeah. I can ask the mayor's office. Is that something you'd like to see, Jay? Is that something others would like to see?
I don't know if we want to just pick from a small group or open it up to the whole city.
I mean, I think it's always good to have more choices. Mm-hmm. I can certainly ask the mayor's office.
Well, I don't think, I mean, there's no harm in us privately sending out Facebook blasts or, right?
Mm-hmm. I had mentioned it to Molly, that's what brought her here. So I think the combination of word of mouth mm-hmm. and some kind of posting our announcement might be a good mix.
I mean, by the way, I just want to let you know that I did pass on to the mayor the characteristics that we were looking for at one of our last meetings for a potential commissioner. I didn't hear anything back, but that means nothing. I never hear anything back from there. All right, so I bring that up. In part to ask that question. One is, have other people heard of anything and should, you know, you want to get the word out a little more? And then the other is that for Molly, who I think actually is a very strong candidate, I know her personally, she's got she's a conservation biologist and has a lot of tree knowledge. She's also, I've worked with her in a team, and I think she's just a thoughtful person. And has good follow through and is a good team player. But for her, the constraint of us meeting on Wednesdays is a deal breaker. So one of the things I did want to ask, and maybe this could be, if this could be known by other people, then maybe we'd get a wider pool of potential applicants, and that is, are we available any other days to meet? You know, we've been meeting on Wednesdays at 4 o'clock now for a year and a half, but our schedules may have shifted. And there's one fewer of us. So maybe, you know, maybe we want to quickly look and say, are there other days when we could meet? So we could do that now, or I could do it with a doodle.
I would do it with a doodle.
Because you want to sit down and think on it?
Think about it.
Okay.
And when you do it, there's also changing the time, possibly, as you apply here. So it could be 4:45, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, although I did check in with Rich about that, and Rich has a strong preference of doing it at 4 o'clock because it's you roll right out from work to...
Right, I mean, it would be easier for me. It would be easier for Terry, I think, as well.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to narrow this right now because, I have already checked in with Rich about this. Rich, remind me, there are really only a couple of days you'd be able to consider, right? Was it Thursday and Friday?
No, I don't want to do a Friday.
No, Friday.
Not Tuesdays.
No, so we can't, it's really, you can't do Tuesdays because of conflict with the transportation or parking.
Okay.
So Tuesday would be out for staff. So it would be Wednesday.
Thursday, I think I remember.
Wednesday, Thursday. I can't do Thursdays.
Yeah, I don't think I can do Thursdays either.
How about Mondays?
Mondays would be. Mondays would be all right as well.
All right, so you two definitely cannot do Thursdays.
Yeah, Thursdays.
Well, you can do Tuesdays, just not the third Tuesday of the month.
Well, that's easy to avoid. You know.
The only other issue would be is if we're gonna switch our days, then we have to make sure we have a meeting space. Because I don't know if this, how far out this meeting space is reserved for other things.
Yeah.
That's the only other thing for it to change.
Okay.
And is time works best later to?
It works better for me personally because I'm just coming from, I'm coming from the office. I work in the office for an extra hour and then I can come.
Does anyone know right off the bat that they can't do Mondays? Because I won't do a doodle with Mondays. Okay. So it looks like that I'll be asking you about Tuesdays, but not the third Tuesday of the month. Mondays, and we already know about Wednesdays. So that really, that's it. Okay. Okie dokie. That's it for that. Any other comments about filling the vacancy?
Are there any other applicants that we know of?
I haven't heard anyone.
I don't know. I mean, there were more. There were far more applicants than we are for the original commission. And I don't know if the mayor has even gone back to those people to see if they're still interested. I have no idea what he's done.
I don't think he has. I have the applications.
Well, he would have them too.
Not that I've seen.
I thought we kept him in our envelopes.
Is he looking to you to go back to those people and see?
He hasn't said anything to me. He just said keep him posted if you know of any folks that are interested.
Okay.
I mean, I think it would be kind of interesting. I've never seen it done. I can't remember. How did they advertise for the last public shooting commission?
Was it the original?
Yes. I can't remember how he advertised in a sense, like on social media, on the city's website, you know, looking for new.
I think he threw something out,
yeah.
You know, on Facebook, just for new tree commission starting up.
So I mean, you could ask him to do that.
Uh-huh.
You know, we have a vacancy of the public safety commission. All residents can apply.
I could even craft a press release.
Good.
I think it's a good idea to cast a wider net.
Yeah.
Always. We may not even know. Maybe somebody moved to the city.
And I'm just telling you now that, I mean, given that Todd and Jen can't do Thursdays, I don't think Molly's going to be able to even apply because she's out. She works Monday and Wednesday afternoons. She might be able to do Tuesdays, if not on the third. So that's possible. Is there any? Oh, I'll do the doodle book. Yeah. Okay. So I'll check in with the mayor. Maybe if
I just
you want.
Asked him to do a Facebook and a tweet. I don't think a press would pick up a single vacancy.
Yeah, you probably right. Okay, but at least I'll craft the language. Gives me more control. All right. Moving right along, tree planting list review. Jen, this one's yours.
Does anybody mind if I close the window?
So I met with Jay and what we did was we went through the Vermont tree selection guide and kind of cross-referenced it with the recommended urban tree site assessment and tree selection for stress tolerance, which is a Cornell publication out of the Urban Horticulture Institute. So this there's a face sheet that I'm happy to have anybody correct language or add things or, what I was trying to communicate with the cover sheet was that just don't pick a plant off of this, that you need to like look at the site and then choose the plant, because that is kind of what often happens. Oh, here's a list. Oh, I'll just pick here, pick, you know? Like, what I would like to do is encourage people who are choosing the plant material to actually look at these documents to figure out whether the plant is going to be appropriate for the site. Height-wise, shade, you know? And you don't have to be, you know, a total tree geek or scientist.
Gives you all the information.
The document, yeah.
Okay.
And there's very specific varieties that are recommended also. So I just grouped them by common name because I thought it would be easier for people to read them. So if anybody already got some feedback from Rob that I'm going to kind of look at, there was a couple suggestions. And,
we didn't want this to be the limit of the list.
Why not?
Well, I think there will be exceptions along the way.
That's not how laws work.
Uh-oh.
So we didn't list every possible hawthorn. We didn't list every possible crab tree.
But if they go to the Cornell book, if they go to this resource, you can look, and these are the best varieties to choose. I mean, there's a whole list of them. I mean, this would be, we were trying to avoid, we wanted a one-pager, you know?
Yeah.
I know you've got this PRINS NST. It took me a little while to figure out if this relates to that.
I can put it on this document.
Yeah.
I just couldn't figure out how to have one page in columns and one page not in columns. I couldn't. That was my
That's word nightmares.
I'm not that good.
So you'll have a little notation and
so I can make a little star and put it, yeah.
Yeah.
And the term OS was used last time off street.
Oh, okay, instead of.
Nice plant, and
instead of NST?
OS was used in the document that Jay put together years ago for the Northampton acceptable tree.
Oh, I can do either one.
Well, then you'd be putting OS near almost every tree. Whereas NST is just a few things you've indicated, right?
I think it's the same thing.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, off street. Like, I'm happy to use off street.
I think not a street tree is clearer.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Frankly.
Agreed.
Okay.
All right. Well, I mean, I think it's a good start and nice cross referencing. I think maybe showing an example of how you should use the Vermont guide with this might be helpful, especially if, you know, under your hawthorns or whatever, there are other varietals that are acceptable to say, you know, this is how this is supposed to work.
Okay,
and also whet their appetite by hopefully we could pull some sort of graphic from that document to show how kind of cool it is and how they're supposed to use it, you know, based on various site characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing I thought that might be helpful was this, I think some of these might be street trees, but they're specialty, you know, or underwire trees, I would hope. I mean, I hope we're not planting smoke trees as a major street tree or whatever.
Yeah.
So right. We might want to call out like specific ones that are, you know, underwire or.
Have you, like a UW?
Yeah.
Okay. I can do that.
And then I have specific questions around the cedars, larches, redwoods, hemlocks.
Right. So is this being recommended? My assumption was, let's say there's a developer that's, you know, not just planting street trees, but also, whatever, putting trees in landscapes in a, like in Hospital Hill or other developments. I was assuming this document would cover that as well, you know? What I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So they would be putting ashes somewhere.
Based on our tree inventory, might we also want to say, like, have a link to the results so people can see what does exist, and might we want to recommend some of these to add diversity to our tree canopy? Are there any on here that really are
overused?
Overused or underrepresented? Based on inventory.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Hmm. I have a bullet for, based on our recent tree inventory results, we might recommend the following species to boost our tree canopy diversity.
Or to not plant maple trees.
It could be either add more or don't add as many.
Yeah. Hmm. I think when the inventory gets written up in those trees, we're going to find that there are like a handful of trees that cover almost the whole city. I might be wrong. In other words, that they're just maples and oaks. I don't think there's a very long list. And so maybe, I do think that we'll all know what that list is. And we'll, as you're saying, and maybe we should say that these trees are overplanted. There isn't a way now going online making that list for us. Somebody's print out the percentages.
You mean the tree inventory?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't do anything until they're actually downloaded up there. Until they're downloading it. Right.
Well, we'll have that information soon enough.
Yeah.
Right, so I very much support what Marilyn's saying, that information system.
Including.
In the most basic way, like when there's a genus that's very, very overplanted.
Currently overplanted in our city.
Yeah.
Avoid planting these if possible.
Right. And for instance, I noticed there were a bunch of honey locusts planted on Hospital Hill. That seemed kind of a necessary use of locusts. So in the previous list that Jay Hilton made, did say locusts, use caution, overplanted.
I mean, there's something, yeah, so I don't know if, I mean, there's something very simple and streamlined about a list like this, and that it's just species, which is really nice. But we want to make sure that people can, like, zoom quickly to other details. And right now, their only way of doing it is to go to these two links.
Right.
Right. So, yeah, I agree that then there might need to be, like, an intermediary of at least, like priority trees or categorized by size or something that gives people another layer before they go to the next.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask, so what is the purpose of having some of these evergreens on here?
I just included them. We just literally went through the Vermont one and the Cornell one. So my thought was, okay, let's say there's a housing development and they put in like this playground area and they want to put some evergreens in there. So they plant a bunch of hemlocks. You know, if we don't have any recommended evergreens, then, you know, there won't be any evergreens.
Can we put
But also, so here's some evergreens you could choose from. Don't pick a hemp, you know.
Can we put this as NST?
I think they are.
Sure.
Did. You all the spruces, pines. NST.
All of them are.
Did
first,
I miss any
all
of them?
All are NST. Yeah.
Well, I got redwoods.
Well, redwood is not is deciduous, so that would be good.
Oh, Don Redwood. So that was one of my questions. So Don Redwood and Bald Cypress. Are we? I mean, they're planting them as street trees now, and then you have to go and move them up. You know.
So what's your feeling?
Yeah.
You've been planting them. You think they're doing all right?
I think they do. I think they do really well, actually. They're very tolerant of salt.
Don Redwoods or Bald Cypress or both?
Bald Cypress. I have not mentioned Don Redwoods. Bald Cypress are extremely common. I don't think I have lost one. But you have a tendency to lose the lower branching.
Well, you have to because you can't see.
Right, you can't see.
You've got to put them up.
They're not pruned properly. Like in Florence, I noticed today there's stubs on one of the trees that stick out like
eyeball, yeah.
Yeah, they're eyeball breakers.
Mm-hmm. How are they for providing shade? Just don't think of them as great shade trees.
Well, let's see. The two biggest bald cypresses around that I know of are in Hatfield, actually, on the corner of North Street and Main Street. And they're huge. It's kind of hard to say how they provide shade.
Big size one on North Maple in Florence.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
They do.
They do. They provide a lot of sidewalk shade.
Yeah, they do provide a lot of sidewalk shade.
And also, there are diversity.
But they have to be limbed up.
Yes.
We just, my school, we just went and pruned, I mean, it was like a traffic island. And you couldn't see the other trees.
They'd be categorized like a young tree train. You know, one of those trees you have to go back and continue train it to just lose the lower branching and make sure they're pruned properly. The other thing, too, is the trunk, because of their branching structure, when they're street trees on narrow streets, they have a tendency to have it. Even if you limb the lower branches up, the upper branches get broken from box trucks.
All right. Should we, I want to make sure that we keep moving along on our agenda. And so one question I have is, do you want to make some changes to this and bring it back to the next? I don't feel like we have to rush into this, right?
Yeah, I just need people to give me feedback. And okay. I'm happy to, like, I'm not married to any of this, really. You know, this was just a format I thought that people would actually look at. And I can get somebody, I have to get somebody to help me to figure out how to show an example. Because I won't, I got to get somebody to help me.
Yeah, I don't know how you do that.
But I get what you're saying. I totally understand what you're saying. I do have a quick question about, and I think I have an idea of how to get a diagram that we can use. And then my question is there, like, all trees should be planted according to, is there an ISA standard or the...
Yeah, we don't want to include it.
We can't do that.
No, we could, but I don't like it.
Okay. Is there one you like, or is there a
planting specs?
I just didn't know if there was
written
out. Like, I'm going to try to find a graphic that this is the proper planting way. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think we should have a video of Rob planting a tree and just say like this.
What a bad idea.
Yeah.
Doesn't DCR have?
Oh, maybe they do.
I mean, they have some of them on
the list.
Yeah, I just couldn't find one. It's
great.
I
couldn't find how to plant a tree.
Right, but I'm trying to find like a graphic that here's a diagram of what you can the way we want it.
Yeah.
And a developer could just like, okay, this is what I want.
It's hard to find a single graphic.
Yeah.
Last one.
All right. So to make this valuable to landscape architects and also homeowners who are going to be like deciding, mm-hmm. I personally think it would be interesting and perhaps beneficial to break it up by, you know, like the canopy trees that are street trees, underwire trees that are suitable for underwire,
okay.
And then,
I can go that way.
You know, parking lot and other maybe setback trees, although I'm not sure about that. And kind of specialty trees like screening, habitat, edible species, that type of thing. And just break it up by those general attributes so that as a homeowner, I know I want a big boy in my front yard. I can choose from these 20 subspecies. And then obviously your setback trees can include all underwire trees and all the big boys and also these weirder things that are more suitable for private property. You know,
I think
you can say, I think you can break it up in some semblance of that would be helpful for homeowners and developers who are quite frankly not going to spend,
right,
unless they're really pushed,
no,
a whole
right
lot of time going back and forth and cross
Yeah, numbers. Yeah. Okay. I can totally do that. That's a good idea. Yeah, I just this is what I did.
Yeah, no, it's great.
Well, it's a great start, thank you.
Yeah, the more feedback, if you have other feedback, please just email me, because I...
Can anyone hear that?
Yeah.
Good. Thank you, Jen.
Yep.
For that hard work, appreciate it, and Jay. All right, planting update, Rob?
Okay, so we've planted about 66 mostly setback trees with volunteers. We have about 10 ready to go this weekend, next few days. And I think we'll probably end up with about 80. It's been really nice. I think the awareness, partly because of the tree bags, is very great when I go places. People, they're not exactly sure how the trees got there and how to get one themselves exactly, but they know there's a program of some kind that's going on. Lots of trees are showing up. And I think it's changing. I think we're making a bit of a cultural shift in that people are really recognizing that it's a really good thing to see trees showing up. Getting a lot of positive feedback, so I feel really good about that.
Yeah, we've had people come out and thank us. It's not even the place where we're putting the tree, it's not their yard. Yeah.
Right, exactly. People are walking down the street, they stop, they talk. And now we have, from Rich, we have Beth to say, Northampton tree volunteer.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is.
Yeah, the high biz, those are good.
Because it has been a little frustrating, like, over the previous year, sometimes we'd be planting a tree, nobody knows who it is, why we're doing it, or that this is a program. And I guess I'm just saying that's shifting, partly the best, partly just general awareness.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And the website from Tree, I'm sorry, treenorthampton.org, Facebook, different thing. It's filtering in. So that we also have trees on many, many streets and neighborhoods. So it's really great. I did go to the inventory. I already mentioned this, but I just want to, the inventory that's brand new, and I've been spending time looking at it. And I am very impressed that the trees we're planting, yellowwood right now, yellowwood, tulip, sweet gum, swamp white oak, American hornbeam, hackberry, buckeye, and to some extent American elm, there are almost none. The only tree that we're planting that there are large numbers of are chinook. We're only planting four right now, so very limited. I think it's really great that this diversity is coming, and I do encourage that we somehow, for the sake of us that are trying to plan future plantings, be able to integrate the numbers of trees that we've planted into the list of public shade trees, because otherwise we'll never be, I don't think we're going to be able to tip the balance or feel or really understand what we're doing in terms of the plantings. So if we're putting 100 setback trees a year and they're all tulip trees and it doesn't show up, somehow I don't feel our data is, at least in terms of even just measuring our own progress, somehow pretty flawed. So that's the update on planting.
I have a couple of thoughts. The first one is, I agree that there's just some great visibility happening and a cultural shift. And I'm wondering if we could just bring it one step further by getting some kind of a tag on the tree that says, you know, I'm a setback tree that the city of Northampton paid for and planted.
Well, the city paid for and volunteers planted.
Yeah, really important. Right. We can work about the language, but something with fairly big writing, so that someone doesn't necessarily have to trespass on someone's yard to read it. But when we're planting these trees, I'd really love for us to keep the tag for the kind of tree it is on the tree. I just think it's just another point of education for people to say, to go, oh, that's a yellowwood tree. I've never heard of that before. I know that your tree crew, Rich, has told me that it's their policy to just take off all tags.
It is the policy. Yeah. Every tag and ribbon comes off when they get planted.
I can see actually putting, if you're going to actually spend the time to actually make tags that say that this tree was purchased by the city and planted by volunteers from Tree Northampton,
Would the treenorthampton.org has a sort of on their agenda to ask if it would be all right to, we're hoping to make yard signs that would just be temporary. In other words, trees get planted, or put up a yard sign. I mean, you know, like.
Yeah, so like.
Like the CPA does, you know, your CPA dollars going toward this project.
And just, so it wouldn't be attached to the tree, I think, and it would be where you can read it. And then we would, of course, have to have the permission of the homeowner, which we assume we would get. People are very friendly. And then for a season or whatever. And so if we had like 50 signs, they would be constantly being pulled up and going to the next 50 trees.
Yeah,
so we're doing it. A way of doing it, but we were actually in the process and then got distracted making the sign.
It's always next season, Rob.
I know. Attaching it to the tree is interesting, but the trees are often like as much as 20 feet from the sidewalk.
Yeah.
And how big can it be, and if it's whipping around.
Right.
Uh-huh. You know, like that idea better.
Yeah.
Mm.
That's when they're reusable.
Yeah. Right. I mean, these yard signs these days are actually made of plastic.
Right.
They're not paper, the ones that.
Right.
And they're quite durable. They would last for seasons.
I thought about that. They planted one in my yard this week. I was like, I should have a sign on here.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
was a free tree. I got a free tree from
Now, is that something that the city could pay for?
You can sell ads for the other side of it.
Now you're thinking out of the box.
Well, I think we would have done it if the city were paying for it. I mean, we just kind of got to it.
All you got to do is ask.
I know. We stumbled over it, and someone actually went, and Alicia went to a sign place on Route 9 in Hadley on the left and went in there, and it was so much for so many, and then we just never made it. But,
you could do it on the internet.
Yeah. They're inexpensive, and they last. All right, well, that's great. I love the encouragement to ask them.
I think it's a cool idea.
When they come up with a design and send it to the printer.
Because the printer you've been using probably has that format.
You've got a designer on your team.
We've got the designers that want to do it.
Yeah.
So
Marcus Printing, yeah.
All right, that's great. I'm so encouraged. Thank you.
That's a great idea.
I also want to just point out that it was a very short season. Because we didn't start until almost into October sometimes.
October 21st.
So very short season and for tree planting. And we were able to plant 80 trees. So I think the future, I'm not saying we would plant more, but it just shows that it's a formula that works and we'll be able to continue to get volunteers to plant.
Did you get a lot of new volunteers?
We did have quite a few new volunteers, but we had very many fewer volunteers than before.
Uh-huh. And that was somewhat easier, more efficient?
Exactly. It was partly planned. In other words, we found it. There are people who come out and they just come out a few times. They get good at it. They find a lot.
And did they use the database that Marilyn had passed on to them, or is this just all from their own pool of people?
They did use the database.
They did? Okay.
Yes.
So, that's
so everyone, the nice thing is that everyone who did say they wanted to help or participate did get an email saying, hi, we'd like you to, the software that they use to sign up, which I think all of you got, not all of you, those that are tree leaders got a notice saying, hey, nobody liked it, almost very few people used it, we got a very poor response.
The sign up
Jesus was not well received.
You had to get a password.
You have to set up an account. It's a one-time thing, but
yeah. So that was no good, actually.
I see.
But so it ended up, you know, having lots and lots of volunteers is actually a lot of work.
Yeah.
So,
sure.
So having
fewer, more dedicated.
A few handfuls of dedicated people.
I don't know. As I was doing the process, I thought it. I think it would be important to get people in the neighborhood involved in their own neighborhood.
Yes.
Well, I do have some thoughts about that I can bring up at a future meeting.
I would just like to comment on really briefly is that there are three different neighborhood groups now who claim that they're going to organize where the trees are going to go. And by that, I mean find, instead of me knocking on doors, finding people who live to host a tree, they're going to find people, and they're going to come out and plant with us. Now, this, so I'm saying yes, Jay, that's the way it should be. It's not been quite that way, although one nice thing, and you worked in on some of this, that some of the people receiving trees did come out and work with us this time. But we're talking about a whole nother level where there's like a neighborhood. So there are a few streets that are looking for lots of trees in the next year or two.
Yeah, so let's put that on a future agenda, because I do think that that's an interesting concept, and maybe it would be a good opportunity to invite Tree Northampton to that discussion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because, you know, there are some precedents. We know that Pat James, who came to us from Philadelphia, did it extensively with tree stewards, with tree tenders. And then we know that in Amherst, they have a similar kind of neighborhood organizing. Right. So I think there's some, it's been a proven successful model in other communities. All right, I want to move us along. Thank you for all that great work, Rob. I'm very pleased that it's gone so well.
Thank you.
All right, annual report review. We're a little bit behind time, so
I don't have to talk to 10 minutes. As I mentioned at the last meeting, I emailed all the commissioners what I had drafted, and as both Lily and Todd recommended, we should make it more concise, more like an executive summary. So I don't have anything new to report. I was just curious if anybody had any feedback or anything else.
I got to spend some time on it, covering from parties.
Yeah, I was just going to roll it into one single task when the tree inventory summary gets folded into it.
Yep.
Because then, you know, I have not scheduled anything with city council, because I really don't want to do it until we're kind of ready to pull the trigger.
Yep.
So,
And we talked about that at the last meeting, to kind of tailor towards once the tree inventory is completely done, and we kind of have this big kaboom.
Exactly.
There was a thought of maybe let's do an annual report and then save the kaboom for even later, but it was, I think we can figure that out as we go.
Okay, all right.
Okay,
that's all? Okay, thank you. Okay, Richard asked me to put this on the agenda, tree planting grant opportunities. Did you want me to speak specifically about the TD?
Did it expire?
The deadline is actually November 23rd, so it's right upon us. I think it would be a challenge, not impossible, but a challenge to try to...
I guess it was one of the things that was actually on an earlier meeting agenda that wanted to speak to?
It wasn't on an agenda. I think we had just had a conversation amongst ourselves, and I'm happy to talk about, I would love for people to, I think that I, when I sent the email about this meeting, I sent a link, I hope I did, to the TD Street Tree.
A couple of weeks ago.
I don't know, I can't remember.
For the agenda?
Yes, for the agenda, did I?
I think I missed it.
Anyway, you can just Google TD, I think it's called Green Streets.
Like TD Bank you're talking about?
Yes. And let me just back up a little bit.
It was no link.
No link? Okay. I meant to. This is one of the few, in all honesty, ways that communities can apply for money for tree planting. And it's been brought to my attention by Molly Freilisher. And it is specifically for planting in low-income neighborhoods. Sounds good. I dug into the details, and here's the part that rubs me the wrong way. And I'm just gonna lay it on the table, and you'll know my bias. And we can all hash it out, okay. TD Bank is the single largest investor development of the Canadian tar sands and the Keystone XL pipeline. So they have been definitely targeted by the fossil fuel free movement as a company to avoid. And I will say that Northampton has taken a stand. It signed a resolution, unanimous resolution. Actually, it wasn't unanimous. I think Dave Murphy abstained. Digesting from fossil fuels, and so any investments in fossil fuels. You could see this separately from this granting opportunity they have, in which, you know, they provide, I don't know, maybe probably several million dollars worth of money to communities all around the states, and I think in Canada too, for the purpose of planting trees. But it doesn't come without promoting TD Bank. So that's the thing. This is not a grant without an exchange. The exchange is that we do a media blast, that there be signage, that there be, you know, visible public recognition of their granting of this. So the maximum any community could get is $20,000 for tree planting. In my estimation, $20,000 is a small amount of money for the exchange that they get, which is a lot of greenwashing. So in my view, I would rather see us seek those funds in other ways. And I believe that, you know, based on our survey of our community, that we already have a lot of people right here ready to write checks about trees if we ask. And that I would personally rather start there. So I open it to the floor for other viewpoints.
You said it was for low-income communities?
Yes. Well, it can be for low-income neighborhoods too. So if we targeted certain neighborhoods, we could get that. I could also say, though, that DCR's urban forestry grants give preference to low-income communities too, so, and neighborhoods. So if we were to write a grant for retreeing to DCR, for retreeing neighborhood communities, we wouldn't have to do a 50-50 match, it would be 75-25.
75
them, 25 us. And I know Greenfield, because I read it in the paper last fall. Mm-hmm. Greenfield did that.
That on the same twice a year schedule? Or is that
no? I think it's gone to once
a year now.
And we just missed it.
Yeah. So that would mean that we have to actually this winter spend a little time making a game plan as to what our next foray would be into the grant world through DCR.
It's like subcommittee is what
we need to do. I'm glad you brought this up, Lily, because as important as it is to do such planting, I think that we should show our integrity with the funding source.
Utilities also have money for planting. I don't know what criteria they use.
I think the word integrity was just used. No offense, England-owned National Grid or Connecticut-owned.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not suggesting we be purists, because I think all money is dirty when you dig deep enough. But TD Bank is a particularly egregious one in my mind. And I find that these kinds of things come back and bite you in the butt, and the amount of money you saved is often not worth it. I found that the growth of Northampton saved itself a lot of grief by not courting, big box and big companies, and we were able to court individuals a lot with a lot more enthusiasm, because they knew that we were keeping it hyper local.
Well, I'd be interested in exploring fundraising both with our associated nonprofit or whatever they are yet, and the city attorney's guidance on what we can do to solicit funds for either a public fund or a nonprofit fund that's associated with us. So I think I'm a little unclear exactly what we can do as commissioners to solicit funds for trees. But setting forth a strategy and understanding the legal parameters around that, I think, would be a good place to start.
Okay.
Outside of grants.
Right. Okay. So So you would like to broaden this topic, and maybe this is like a couple of people get together, who a couple of people in, this, in the commission who have a particular interest in this, take this on. We won't call it a subcommittee, because that complicates things, to explore fundraising.
Yeah. I'm just looking at the spreadsheet from the survey responses, too, just to remind myself of the number of people who said that they would be willing to contribute financially.
Like
80
some.
Yeah.
Yeah, and again, it's this whole crowdfunding thing for the park really, I think, opened the door for I mean, if the mayor can ask for money, then I guess we can too.
I don't know if we can, but we could certainly, I just don't really answer that. But we could certainly work with the tree board and the city. I wouldn't want to work separately from the city unless we are working through a nonprofit. I just don't think that's our role. But I am in favor of the idea of fundraising. It's just a matter of how we go about it. Okay. Any other thoughts on this? Is anyone particularly interested in fundraising?
I'm not sure I like to do it, but I'm interested in where we could get, looking at where we can get money.
I like asking people.
Yeah, right down the hall, double doors.
You're looping in with that, with the grant. I mean, that's sort of the same.
Well, grant searching would fall under the broader subject.
Yeah,
because there's like these Truri grants that are you can use them for kind of new environmental like I was thinking like a small, you could do a bioretention thing, or you could do like there's been schools that have switched over to organic ball fields. Master gardeners have done stuff with them, or a small structural soil job. You know, there are other avenues.
Okay. All right. Marilyn, maybe you and I can work on this.
All right. Good. All right.
Because it's a topic I'm interested in, too. Okay, okay.
Just tangent to that. Rich also brought up the budget process, right, which is going to start soon. So if what our role of that is kind of working through you to support your request for X hundreds of thousands of dollars. But you know, that the mayor's gonna start putting that together in like a month.
You mean for 2017-18?
Yeah, FY.
Really? Already?
Yes. We have to start working. The capital budget has already been submitted. Well, ours hasn't. Well, all departments has.
I mean, to me, all things flow from the tree inventory, right?
Yeah.
I mean, because the tree inventory, it justifies every request we make. And so I don't think we can do anything until we get that in.
Well, you could, for example, if you needed ammunition for money to plant trees, you could say without, without the plan they're going to develop, I can't remember the name of it. Without that, you could say, we're under risk because 70% of the trees we have in the canopy are three types, and we need to diversify. For just something as simple as that, you could use from the tree inventory, but you wouldn't have to like do super data mining to find that out. You know what I'm getting at?
I do. I would really love us to really be ambitious on this one. And do something like what Amherst did, which is to ask for an entire project's worth of money, and that means the city bonds. I mean, the mayor himself has already said I'd be willing to look into bonding. So that's why I feel like our time is so perfect. When the inventory is complete, we can say there are X number of planting sites, there is this kind of diversity, there's this percent of trees that are currently in fair to poor condition. You know, this is our vision, this is what we need, and this is what we're asking.
So that'll be a capital expense, and capital budgets, our capital budget deadline is December 1st.
Then maybe we're looking at December 1st the following year. And what we do in the short term is really just get us through 2017-2018.
I'm thinking more, rather than a big shot like Amherst did, having more sustainable, a yearly goal that we're seeking.
We have a very sympathetic mayor right now. That could change.
Yeah.
I just think we need to strike while the iron is hot. We have a mayor who really identifies this as one of his legacy projects. I just don't think we should.
Well, he's gonna run for the election. And when?
When's the
17. And maybe he'll be mayor for another 4 years.
Yeah, but you know what? The financial situation could change.
Right,
I mean, my point
being is that if we're not gonna be prepared to put a capital budget together for a five to 10 year tree planting plan this year, it'll be going next year. Mm-hmm. And the capital budget will be submitted by the Department of Public Works to this present administration. However, the administration, if he doesn't run, will change in January of 18. While the Capital Committee actually ranks the budget requests, Capital Committee ranks the budget requests and they bring it back to the mayor for his yay or nay vote, and then he sends it to the city council, or she, depending upon who it may be, after January of 18.
Okay.
No matter what we are, you know, I totally hear what you're saying, and I agree with you. The mayor is definitely very interested in making this one of his legacy projects, and he sees this as something going forward. But
you two or three of us should meet with him ASAP then.
Yeah. But, you know, the other thing too that we can do is we can also ask for an increase in the OM.
Yeah, there'd be a stopgap filling.
Right, which would be easier for a short term.
If it remains steady.
That's correct. It's a steady flow of money that is in the
budget. Well, we couldn't ask for like $500,000. You could only ask for like a 30.
No,
same thing.
That would be a capital. This would be a capital project. It would be a capital investment. Because you'd have to have a large contract with a large vendor to supply the trees. Then you'd have to decide whether or not we're actually going to plant them all ourselves or have professionals to do them or be supplemented with both. So there's a lot of moving parts with it. You know, Amherst just really bonded the money. They put the money in an account, and that's what they did. They borrowed the money, just like you would if you were to buy a dump truck, $150,000 dump truck. You just borrow the money, and then at the end of the fiscal year, as long as you can roll it over to the following year. But you only roll it so many times. You have to have a contract attached to it of some sort, preferably. So.
Okay, well, because it's 5:30 and we're a little bit off here, I just want to, maybe the three of us should have a conversation. And, I'm a little nervous about us feeling like we need to pull something together by December 1st. That doesn't feel almost prudent, frankly, because we will not have had a chance to really study the data and put together a database request.
I think
we should plant the seed. We should at least, meet with him to say, this is where we're moving. Are you moving in this direction with us? Like, I mean, at least to feel him out?
We can. I mean, the capital request, yeah, you can. The capital request will come from our department through the director. So, but you can have a conversation with him, or you can send him an email after you ask the question, just as the chairperson of the commission. Say we had a conversation about long-range capital planning
yeah.
For possible tree planting for the next 5 years, similar to what Amherst did, after we have the data back from the public shade tree inventory. What are your thoughts? Would you be supportive of a long-range capital planting plan? Just ask them the question, and then we can go from there. We can actually, we'll have the hard data by then, and then we can develop the criteria for the planting plan, or the body of the planting plan.
Who planted all the trees in Amherst? Was it all volunteer?
I believe it's all volunteer.
No, it wasn't. It was mostly Alan with Stockbridge interns. Yeah.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that. They actually used one. They actually did one volunteer planting a month, though.
That's right.
And the rest of it was us. And the rest was stuff with Stockbridge students.
I understood they had like a small team, like two or three people who went through the whole summer planting trees.
They hired two or three interns to work through the summer for several years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, interesting.
All right.
That makes it, not the way they did it is not that different than what we're doing. It's just expanded. In other words, kind of small scale. They didn't have like giant.
Right.
So people
except they were full time.
Right, exactly.
Right.
So,
right. And then, yeah. Right.
It was essentially stretching out what we're doing, stretching it out to three or 4 months or 5 months rather than to a few weeks.
All right. So, all right. We'll talk about that. Does the rest of the commission support us?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Okay. I just wanted
clarity, that's a good catch.
When you go, you're talking about not submitting for this December or the following one, or you're not sure?
I'm not sure yet. Oh. It really depends on how ready to go the mayor is.
Right.
You know, if he's like, go for
that's
it,
good.
Then we'll move as fast as we can. But if he says, the data's still in, I really need to study it, we need to put together a compelling, he's got to go through city council, so it's got to be a really, you're asking for a lot of money. And my suspicion, knowing David, is it's going to be the latter. I mean, he's really...
He keeps asking me to need more money. I'm like, at the moment, he catches me off guard. I'm like, sure, whatever you can give us.
You mean with regard
to trees?
Yeah. Okay, yes. Well,
I think that's really, we also, I think Donna, I give Donna an attaboy because she's been very good about securing funding for other things we need in our department presently. So right now we have really two very good advocates. We have the mayor, and we also have the director. Would be integral in working with this capital plan because she's the one that would put the capital plan together with input from myself and the commission. So, but I don't know if this year would be this year. It's not in the capital plan radar for tree planting this year. The capital plan radar for this year has been mainly a lot of vehicles, fleet replacement, things of that nature, and other large capital infrastructure projects.
Okay. All right.
So, but it's the question you need to ask.
You got to go. Okay. Let's wrap up here then. The Tree Northampton update, we kind of already did that, right, Bob?
Yes.
Okay. Other business?
Oh, very quickly. I sent edits to Rich who forwarded them to Andy. So if you look at our website, the Tree Commission website, you will see changes made which include the vacancy, which includes our current goals based on our discussion earlier this year, and also a photo of us.
Woohoo! Thank you for doing that, Marilyn.
Yeah,
I really
that's
appreciate
great.
You taking that initiative.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes a difference to have it active.
Oh, and also something about Tree Northampton is now on there.
Okay, to do, let's start with Todd so that Todd can go.
Okay, let's see. Rich is going to plant the remaining trees. You said you just had a few left to go. Schedule tree hearings for
trees.
To be removed from South Street. That's a back burner thing. Lily worked with Jay to identify sites for replanting of South Street trees. Invite Carolyn to meeting. Follow up with the mayor regarding commissioner vacancy and draft press release. Doodle poll for possible meeting date change. Future agenda item, neighborhood tree tenders, that's what we're calling them. Research funding options for tree planting in low-income communities, which I'll help you with. Jay, work with Lily to identify those sites for South Street tree plants. Jen and Jay at the tree list based on feedback from the commission today. Rob complete, oh, you did complete tree plantings. Are there any remaining?
This weekend.
This okay. Design a tree sign for new plantings. Everybody, if you haven't already, review the annual report and send me any edits or thoughts. And then Lily, Rich, and Todd meet with the mayor as soon as possible to really interest in long-range capital planting based on our tree inventory.
Okay.
I'll get those two, Terry.
Okay.
All right. Motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.